So the British conceived of two possible threats from Western rivals as far as Indian security was concerned. So they positioned very strong representation across the Gulf, beginning from the 18th century and continuing up to recent times. So this is how they confronted the Russian threat in terms of the great game, as they called it, and they confronted the French threat by positioning all these offices. But something else happened. Beyond the strategic interest that the British had in maintaining control over the Gulf. And that was oil. In 1912, a fateful decision was taken by the British to shift powering their navy from coal to oil. This was much more efficient. It was the natural culmination of events that were part of the Industrial Revolution and the evolution of the single combustion engine. So you shifted to oil. But you didn't have enough oil of your own. You didn't have any oil of your own. You had a lot of coal, but you didn't have oil. Therefore, the British took a deliberate policy decision to dominate those territories that were rich in oil. So it began with Iran and the setting up of the Anglo-Persian Oil Company, which was 50% owned by the British government. And later on, the British participated in the creation of Iraq. The domination of the Arab world goes back to the arrangements of Al-Fatah. That even as in the case of India, there was a freedom movement that was reverberating across South Asia. In the case of West Asia, it was decided that rather than they become free, they should continue to be dominated by the imperialist powers. This was enshrined in the Versailles arrangements. During the First World War itself, the Arab people were subjected to two betrayals. One was the fact that while they were told that they would be free of Ottoman rule if they supported the Allies against the Turks, they would have a freedom and self-government. We know on the basis of the Sykes-Picot arrangement that there was a plan, in fact, which was completely different, in terms of which the Arab world would be dominated, would continue to be dominated by the Anglo-French alliance on the basis of the mandate arrangements of the League of Nations. The second betrayal, of course, was the Balfour Declaration, where it was announced by the British government that a Jewish homeland would be created in Palestine. So these were the two betrayals. What the Versailles arrangements envisaged was initially direct and later indirect Anglo-French hegemony across this region, which meant that not only would you politically and militarily control this region, you would, even if over a period of time you had indigenous rulers, those indigenous rulers would be subservient to your interest rather than to the interests of their own country and people. This was an intervention, a continuum of the imperialist order, albeit with sometimes a different shape in that you pretended that the ruler was there and the ruler was supposed to be a little more free from the imperialist rule. In the case of imperialist rule, you had direct rule of a viceroy or a governor general. Here you had local potentates that emerged, but they, in terms of their functioning, they were entirely subservient to the Western alliance. The Western alliance also provided for intervention in the politics, that if you found any ruler who was not entirely subservient as he should be, then you had provision to get rid of him and to appoint someone else. They manipulated all the lines of this region. Every line that was drawn on the map was drawn up in the aftermath of Versailles. It was originally, this was to be a united territory. There was to be an Arabia and there was to be a greater Syria. It was systematically, you have seen these numerous lines that were drawn. Some were drawn just after the First World War and some were drawn after the Second World War. The First World War lines were were in West Asia and Second World War lines were in the Gulf. But the lines were all drawn by the Western Alliance, by the Anglo-French Alliance. So Syria, instead of being a greater Syria, you had five or six countries that were created deliberately on the basis of divide and rule policies. So that you created a Lebanon that was Christian majority in order to ensure that French influence would be perpetual, would be there in perpetuity. So all these were in fact artificial lines, because there was a sense of greater Syria. But then they had to accommodate certain rulers whom they had betrayed in Arabia, so they were planted in Syria initially as well as in Iraq. So this was the scenario that prevailed after Versailles. It continued to prevail after the Second World War. Only thing is that the powers changed hands. And more in West Asia, you started seeing America replacing the Anglo-French alliance as the dominant role player in the politics of the region. The politics itself, the imperialist approach did not change. Western hegemony continued to reverberate across the region. Therefore, the region was entirely politically regarded. There were certain things that happened. From time to time, there were revolutions, coup d'etat. This was to get rid of certain rulers who had been planted by imperialism, and you had military dictatorships that emerged. And these military dictatorships were supposed to be anti-West, but in due course, many of them got co-opted into the Western order. Or they were stigmatized and there was a certain sense of opposition to them. So you had a political scenario of the region consisted of sustained authoritarian rule across the territory, made up of two kinds of authorities. Number one, traditional monarchies, who claimed a right to rule on the basis of some imaginary historic justification, either because you were a tribal chief or you were a principal family or you adhered to certain principles, Islamic in character, that gave you a legitimacy. And of course you were, most of these, in fact all of them, were entirely subservient to the West, who ensured their continued rule. Wherever you had coup d'etat, you had military dictatorship, or you had power.